Good morning. Thank you, organizing committee and the judges for allowing me to present in this prestigious award session the results of our work on ARF and RHD. So RHD still remains a major health problem in India, and ARF is conventionally diagnosed based on the modified Jones criteria, but the supportive investigations in this criteria have a very less sensitivity and specificity, which more often leads to either underdiagnosis or overdiagnosis of ARF. So in the process of a patient with acute rheumatic fever getting onto into the rheumatic heart disease, there are multiple factors, the most important which is repeated valvular injuries due to recurrent episodes of ARF. So for a cardiologist practicing in an endemic RHD endemic area, it is not uncommon to encounter a patient who has been a case of stable RHD with symptomatic worsening when multiple causes go through in his mind. Many a times the cause would be obvious, but very often she or he might not be able to reliably attribute the cause of worsening to a fresh episode of rheumatic activity. So another question which always pops up when we discuss rheumatic heart disease is that this is the issue of pancarditis. Conventionally, it is thought to involve all three layers of the heart, but there have been multiple direct and indirect evidences that have ruled out the possibility of significant myocardial involvement. And multiple studies have tried to reinforce the fact that endocardial injury is a predominant mechanism resulting in valvular dysfunction. However, there are no studies that have looked at specifically at the peripheral blood markers of endothelial function and endothelial injury in this population. And we planned this study to try and find answers to these two questions, which have been perplexing the cardiologists for a long time. So we aim to look at levels of novel peripheral blood markers among patients with ARF and compare it with that of chronic RHD patients without acute rheumatic fever in an attempt to enlist potential biomarkers that could help in the reliable identification of ARF. So before we go on to discuss what all biomarkers we had enlisted, it is important to understand the mitral valve ultrastructure. The mitral valve is nothing but layers of extracellular matrix, which is predominantly composed of collagen, lined on the either sides by endothelium. And during acute rheumatic fever, it is the endothelium and collagen which bears the maximum brunt. So we hypothesize that peripheral blood markers of endothelial activation, endothelial injury, and markers of collagen turnover would be significantly different among patients with ARF when compared to patients with chronic or stable phase of RHD. So we planned it out to be a prospective case control study as a collaborative project between All India Institute of Medical Sciences and National Institute of Immunology, New Delhi. Patients less than 21 of years who are diagnosed with ARF based on Jones criteria would comprise the cases, and stable RHD patients without ARF would comprise the controls. We also included age-matched healthy controls to serve as a baseline. So blood was collected from all the participants, and ELISA for markers of extracellular matrix remodeling, markers of collagen turnover, and soluble adhesion molecules were performed. In the other set of samples, we centrifuged it, and the buffy coat containing peripheral blood monocytes were subjected to flow cytometry and fluorescence-activated cell sorting for isolation and enumeration of endothelial progenitor cells. The plasma component was further subjected to graded centrifugation and followed by transmission electron microscopy and dynamic light spectroscopy for isolation and enumeration of microparticles. The importance of these microparticles and EPCs, I would be detailing it in the further slides. So we included 41 patients with ARF and 20 patients with chronic RHD. And the mitral valve was the most common valve involved. And coming on to the markers one by one, the MMP, which is the matrix metalloproteinase, which is released by activated fibroblasts and endothelial cells in response to acute inflammation, was significantly elevated in the ARF group compared to the RHD group. Whereas the inhibitors of this metalloproteinase, all the categories of inhibitors were elevated in the ARF group. But what is important to note is that the ratio between the metalloproteinases and its inhibitors, though it was also higher in the ARF group, it was it could be interpreted in the other way, that the ratio of the inhibitors were higher in proportion to the metalloproteinases in the RHD group, which could explain that the system was more tuned towards collagen deposition rather than collagen degradation in this chronic RHD group patients. Correspondingly, markers of collagen 1 degradation, namely the CTX1, was increased in ARF group, and markers of intermediates of collagen synthesis, namely the P1CP, which is procollagen type 1 carboxy terminal propeptide, it was elevated in the chronic RHD group, suggesting that more fibrosis and more collagen deposition was happening in the RHD group, and more collagen lysis was happening in the ARF group. The vascular endothelial growth factor, which is a released by the endothelium in response to stress and inflammation was significantly elevated in the ARF group. Coming on to the circulatory adhesion molecules, which are markers of endothelial activation and leukocyte transmigration, they were surprisingly not elevated in ARF or the chronic RHD group. In fact, the healthy population were having higher levels, finding which we were unable to explain, and it was contrary to our expectations. The other marker was endothelial progenitor cell, which I had mentioned before. These are nothing but precursors of endothelial cells which are released from the bone marrow. They can be classified into hemangioblastic or monocytic EPCs based on the CD markers on their surfaces. And hemangioblastic EPCs are the true precursors of endothelial cells, which are released from bone marrow in response to VEGF. And we could see that hemangioblastic EPCs and their early, both the early and late phases, all were significantly higher in the ARF group compared to the chronic RHD group. Similarly, monocytic fraction of the EPCs, which are known to help the hemangioblastic counterparts to get recruited to the site of damage, they were also significantly elevated in the ARF group. Both of these suggest that there is significant endothelial injury and endothelial activation happening in patients with ARF, which is not present in chronic phase of the disease. Coming on to microparticles, which are a class of extracellular vesicles which are released when a cell undergoes apoptosis. So in order to quantify the amount of endothelial repair happening, total microparticles, endothelial specific microparticles, and EPC specific microparticles all were enumerated and compared with the ratios of the microparticles to their corresponding cells were compared. So these were the electron microscopic and dynamic light spectroscopy method of characterization and enumerating these microparticles. The total microparticles and the endothelial specific microparticles were significantly higher in the chronic subjects as compared to the acute rheumatic fever subjects. Similarly, all the fractions of hemangioplastic EPC specific microparticles and the monocytic EPC specific microparticles were significantly elevated in comparison to their cellular counterparts in chronic RHD patients compared to the ARF group. So to summarize our findings, in acute rheumatic fever patients, the extracellular matrix remodeling proteins, namely the collagen degradation products and the inhibitors of metalloproteinases and metalloproteinases, are significantly elevated, and damaged endothelium results in increased endothelial progenitor cells. And it is encouraging to know that the ELISA technique which we followed is the ELISA panels for estimation of these markers are available on commercial basis. Whereas in the chronic RHD group, though there was elevation in EPC, the endothelial progenitor cells, but the microparticles were much more elevated than the cellular counterparts, meaning that most of the EPCs are getting apoptosized rather than going to the endothelium and take part in endothelial repair, which was happening in ARF. So this was the first study to comprehensively study a very broad range of peripheral blood markers. So the strength of the study being it's a translation research on a very important condition that is very much relevant to our setting. And it has followed very novel and sophisticated laboratory techniques. And we had tried to look at changes at ultrastructural level that had led to or had resulted from alterations in the blood level of markers which were enlisted by previous studies. And limitation is obviously the limited sample size and less than 1:1 case control ratio in our study and a heterogeneous sample. Had we enrolled patients only with first episode of ARF, it would have been a better study, as also suggested by one of the reviewer. But the difficulties with finding such samples is we know the difficulty of finding patients with first episode of ARF. So to conclude, endothelial injury is the predominant pathophysiologic mechanism in ARF. The internal biochemical milieu is geared towards collagen or extracellular matrix degradation in acute rheumatic fever and collagen synthesis in RHD. And correspondingly, the markers of collagen degradation are elevated in ARF and markers of collagen turnover are increased in RHD. The role of EPCs and microparticles remains to be elucidated in much more detail. And this study would definitely be an attempt to consolidate the gains we had made in the last few decades in terms of RHD research in India. And this study would serve as a basis for much more bigger clinical translational research, which has to be undertaken in this topic. Thank you. And I thank the reviewers for their comments, and we have tried to include them in the